Hello everyone, welcome to Lukman IAS. Today we are going to discuss about Indian agriculture through previous year questions of UPSC preliminary examination. Now let us see the topics that we are going to understand for the day. We will understand about zero tillage farming, then we will learn about pulse production, then we will understand about subtropical crops, then we will understand about sugarcane cultivation. Then we will learn about eco-friendly agriculture. And these topics are relevant from this particular subheading of the syllabus that says current events of national and international importance. And at the same time, these topics can be connected with geography of India and world, and it can also be connected with environment and ecology related topics. Okay, so let us take the first question for the day. Okay, so this question says, what is or are the advantage or advantages of zero tillage in agriculture? Okay, so as you can see over here that this question revolves around zero tillage agriculture. What do we mean by zero tillage agriculture? Zero tillage agriculture is a practice in agriculture where we are not ploughing or we are not tilling the land before sowing the next crop. Okay, so zero tillage agriculture is a new method, okay, of, you know, of agricultural productivity. Okay, so let us read these statements one by one, then we will answer these questions. Statement one says, sowing of wheat is possible without burning the residue of previous crop. Okay, yes, this is possible, means like we do not burn the previous crop before sowing the wheat. I mean, like, this is a practice under zero tillage agriculture. Yes, this is possible. Okay, statement one is correct. If statement one is correct, we can eliminate option B, we can eliminate option C. Okay, now let us take the next statement. It says, without the need for nursery of rice saplings, direct planting of paddy seeds in the wet soil is possible. Okay, so they are saying, like, without the usage of nursery of rice saplings, direct planting of paddy seeds in the wet soil is possible. Yes, we can directly plant the paddy seeds in the wet soil as well. Okay, so this is also possible. Okay, statement one and two are correct. Now let us also read the third statement, which says carbon sequestration in the soil is possible. Yes, definitely carbon sequestration in the soil will keep on happening as it is, okay, without any kind of, you know, disruptions into that. So all these statements are correct. It means option D is the right answer for this. Okay, so this is the thing. And under this zero tillage agriculture, we also use a, you know, technique which is known as direct seeded rice. Okay, direct seeded rice, in short it is known as DSR. So what is DSR? It is a process of establishing a rice crop from the seeds sown in the field rather than transplanting seedling from the nursery. Okay, so this second statement that is given in the question, it is about direct seeded rice. Okay, so, and no tilled soil or zero tilled soil is cooler as compared to other soil. Okay, and it promotes conservation agriculture. So D is the right option for this particular question. Okay, and there are various benefits also associated with zero tillage agriculture. Okay, so let us understand what is no-till farming or zero-till farming. I have already discussed, but we are again going to see it. Okay, so no-till farming is a method of growing crops without disturbing the soil through plowing or tilling. Crop residues remains on the soil surface to decompose naturally. Okay, what are the benefits? The benefits include reduced soil erosion caused by plowing or tilling, and other benefit in includes increased soil organic matter, and it also improves the soil structure and aeration. Okay, like with this we get increased beneficial soil microbes, and it helps in retaining soil moisture and water conservation. Then it leads to reduced fuel use from not plowing. Okay, so these are the benefits of no-till farming or zero tillage agriculture. So having understood this, let us now take the next question for the day. This question says, with reference to pulse production in India. Okay, so this question revolves around pulse production in India. Consider the following statements. They have given three statements to us and they have asked which of these statements are correct. Let us read the first statement. It says black gram can be cultivated as both kharif and rabi crops. Okay, yeah, this statement is right. Black gram means urad ki dal. Okay, so it can be cultivated in both the seasons, in the kharif season as well as in rabi season. Okay, so what is kharif season? Kharif season means autumn season. Okay, kharif stands for autumn in English. Okay, we say it to be autumn, and if we are saying rabi, it means we are talking about winter season. Okay, so this particular thing, I mean black gram, okay, black gram can be cultivated in both the seasons. Okay, so that's why statement one is correct. If statement one is correct, we can eliminate option B, we can eliminate option C. Now let us read the second statement also. It says green gram alone accounts for nearly half of pulse production. Okay, this is not correct. Green gram means moong ki dal. Okay, green gram means moong. Okay, it means moong, moong. Okay, so moong is not, you know, does not account for nearly half of the crop production. It accounts for only, okay, it accounts for only 10.04% of the, you know, total harvest. And this particular data has been, you know, has been published by an agency of the government, which is known as Directorate of Economics and Statistics. Okay, it is known as Directorate of Economics and Statistics. I'm just writing the short form. According to this particular organization, in the year of 2018, okay, in the year of 2018 to 19, okay, the out of total production in pulses, TUR accounted for 15.34% of production, gram accounted for 43.29% of production, moong, which is green gram, okay, it accounted for 10.04% of production, and you know black gram, which is known as urad, okay, so that accounts for 13.93% of production. Then lentil was of 6.67%, and other pulses, you know, contributed to 10%, you know, production of that particular financial year. Then let us take the next statement for the day. Okay, so if statement 2 is incorrect, we can eliminate option D. So correct answer for this question is option A, 1 only. Still let us read the third statement, which says in the last 3 decades, while the production of kharif pulses has increased, the production of rabi pulses has decreased. This is incorrect. Like if we, you know, take the data of last 3 decades, the production of both the kharif crop as well as rabi crop has increased. Okay, it has increased, and for this, like I have included you know, data for you. This data graph here, the number one graph, the above graph shows, you know, kharif pulses, production of kharif pulses, and you know, so these are of 5-year plants, from 6th 5-year plant to 12th 5-year plant. So it accounts for more than for around 35 years of data. Okay, so using these data, what we can do, we can analyze how much rice was produced. Okay, so these black boxes, the boxes, not black, the blue boxes that you can see over here, these blue boxes says about area, okay, in lakh hectares where we went ahead with kharif pulses production, and the red boxes shows, you know, the production of kharif pulses in lakh tons. Okay, if we see in the 6th 5-year plan, the production was very less. Okay, and if we see in the 12th 5-year plan, the production was much higher. Okay, if we just, you know, connect these dots over here, we will get to know that overall the production of kharif pulses has increased over the last 3 decades. Okay, over the last 3 decades. Okay, and if we see the, you know, second graph over here, the second graph, the lower one, okay, this talks about, you know, plan wise scenario for Rabi pulses. Okay, it talks about plan wise scenario for Rabi pulses. The blue boxes over here talks about the area in lakh hectares where pulses have been sown, okay, or pulses have been harvested. And the red boxes over here, they show the total production level of Rabi pulses in lakh tons. Here again, if we compare different 5 year data, so we can simply see that there has been an overall increase in the total productivity of Rabi pulses over the last 3 decades or more than last 3 decades. Okay, so that's why the third statement was incorrect. And here I have included some images also for you. The first image that you can see, it is the image of black gram. It is the image of black gram. Black gram means urad. Okay, I'm just writing it over here. Then this is the image of green gram. Okay, this is the image of green gram. So this is, this is moong. Okay, it is known as moong in India. So correct answer for this question is A. It is mentioned over here. And this question was asked in UPSC CSE 2020. Having understood this, now let us take the next question for the day. Okay, so this question says the crop is subtropical in nature. A hard frost is injurious to it. It requires at least 210 frost free days and 50 to 100 centimeters of rainfall for its growth. A light, well drained soil capable of retaining moisture is ideally suited for cultivation of the crop. Okay, so overall they have given details about a particular crop. They have given details through various statements. Now they are asking which one of the following is that crop. Basically, all these statements suits for cotton cropping. Okay, all these statements are suitable for cotton. Means correct answer for this question is A. So this is the image of cotton. You can see cotton production. Okay, so if we discuss about cotton, okay, so cotton grows both in tropical as well as subtropical regions. Okay, so first statement is correct. Okay, and they grow in warm humid climate. They grow in warm, okay, humid climate. Warm humid climate. Okay, so it requires a temperature. If we talk about like how much temperature does it require, it requires a temperature from 20 degree centigrade to 28 degree centigrade. And if we talk about rainfall, how much rainfall does it need? Okay, it need rainfall from 50 centimeter, okay, to 100 centimeter, okay, for its growth. And it requires 210, okay, if we talk about frost free days, the bottom line for frost free days is around 180 days. Means like at least 180 days must be required, but for better crop production at least 210 frost free days are required. Okay, frost free days are required. And what kind of soils, okay, are there where we can grow cotton? Then cotton can be grown in fertile saline soil with high water retention capacity. Okay, and loamy soil with high calcium carbonate is best suited for the cultivation. Okay, so we need loamy soil. Okay, loamy soil with high calcium carbonate. Okay, calcium carbonate, if I'm not wrong, it is CaCO3. Okay, carbonate is suited for cotton cultivation. Okay, so that's all about this question. Now let us take the next question for the day. Okay, this question says with reference to the current trends in the cultivation of sugarcane in India. Okay, so this question is about cultivation of sugarcane in India. Consider the following statements. They have given 4 statements to us, and they have asked us to find out the correct statements from this particular list. Okay, so let us take the first statement. It says a substantial saving in seed material is made when bud chips saplings are raised in a nursery and transplanted in the main field. Okay, yes, this is possible. And like the thing is, I want to talk to you about like we have various methods of producing sugarcane. One of the method is known as tissue culture. Okay, we can go for tissue culture. And another method is known as bird. Okay, it is known as bird chip settling method. Okay, so we have both these methods, and whenever we are using bird chip settling method, what we are doing, we are actually raising the seeds in a particular nursery, means like in a different area we are raising the seeds over here, and after then we are transplanting all these seeds in a field. Okay, and we are raising, okay, we are raising sugarcane over here. Okay, so initially the seed material is grown in a nursery, later on it is transplanted in the area. Okay, so statement one is correct. If statement one is correct, we can eliminate option B, we can eliminate option D. Now let us talk about the second statement for the day. It says, when direct planting of sets is done, the germinated percentage is better with single budded set as compared to sets with many buds. Okay, this statement is incorrect, because like we can have sets of various buds. We can have sets with one bud, we can have sets with two buds or three buds. Okay, so when we are having sets with multiple buds, so like they are going to have more germination percentage as compared to single setted buds. So this particular statement is oppositely written. Okay, so when we talk about single budded sets, they germinate at a lesser percentage as compared to double or triple bedded triple budded sets. Okay, so that's why statement 2 is incorrect. If statement 2 is incorrect, we can eliminate option A as well. So correct answer for this question is option C. Okay, option C is the correct answer. Let us also take the third statement for the day, which says, if bad weather conditions prevail when sets are directly planted, single budded sets have better survival as compared to large budded cells. This is again incorrect, because large budded cells sets have more survival rate or more survival chances as compared to single budded sets. Okay, so that's why third statement is incorrect. Fourth statement, sugarcane can be cultivated using settlings prepared from tissue culture. Yes, this is possible. Okay, I have already discussed about it. Okay, so that's why the correct answer for this question is option C. Okay, option C is the correct answer. This was asked in UPSC CSE 2020. I have taken this question from set A of the question paper, and it was question number 89. Okay, so here I have just included a image for you, so that you can see like how a sugarcane field looks like. Okay, that's the thing. Now let us talk about the next question. Let us read this question. It says, in the context of India, which of the following is or are considered to be practices of eco-friendly agriculture? Okay, so the core theme or the main idea of this question is eco-friendly agriculture. They are saying, which of the following are considered to be practices of eco-friendly agriculture? Okay, crop diversification, yes, this is correct. Legume intensification, yes, this is also correct. Transiometer use, this is correct. Vertical farming, this is also correct. So correct answer for this question is option D. Okay, option D is the right answer for this question. And this question was also taken from UPSC CSE 2020. Set A, question number 19. Okay, so let us understand, what do we mean by crop diversification? Okay, what do we mean by crop diversification? Crop diversification involves addition of new crops or cropping systems. Okay, when we talk about crop diversification, it involves addition of new crops or cropping systems. Then it also involves introduction of a greater range of varieties. Okay, and it increases natural biodiversity. It increases natural biodiversity. Okay, and apart from this, if we talk about legume intensification, what do we mean by legume intensification? What do we mean by legumes? Okay, legumes are a group of plants that have vegetables or as food grown from ground knobs that enhance the ability of nitrogen rich material. Okay, so If we talk about examples of legumes, okay, what are examples of legumes? They can be acacia, okay, they can be acacia, they can be peas, okay, it can be clover, and it can be beans, etc. So these are examples of legumes, okay. So legume intensification improves soil health, especially compared to fallow, okay, by adding nitrogen and organic matter and reducing potential erosion and leaching losses. Okay, so there are various benefits that are associated with legume intensification. One, that it improves the soil health. Second, it increases the nitrogen and organic matter into the soil, and it reduces the potential erosion and leaching losses. Okay, so these are the benefits of legume intensification. If we talk about transiometer, okay, what do we mean by transiometer? Basically, it is an instrument, and for which purpose we do use? For this, we need to understand about a process that is known as tension, okay, into the roots of plant and the soil. Let us understand. So in order to absorb water from soil, the plant has to overcome the suction tension of the soil. Okay, when plants want to absorb water from the soil, they will have to overcome suction tension. Okay, suction tension of the soil. Okay, and this particular suction tension can be measured using an instrument which is known as tensiometer. It is known as tensiometer. Okay, and using this particular tensiometer, what we can do? We can calculate the tension, okay, or we can calculate the soil moisture at a particular depth. Let's consider this is the soil profile over here, and this is the depth. At this depth, we can calculate what is the tension over here. We can calculate what is the tension over here. Tension means we can calculate soil moisture at different depths, okay. So let's consider this is the ground level. This is the ground level, okay. So like we can calculate the tension at various depths, okay. This is the thing. And what do we mean by vertical farming? Vertical farming means growing crops in vertically stacked layers, okay. Vertical farming means growing crops, okay, in vertically stacked layers, and it incorporates controlled environment agriculture, okay. And soilless farming techniques are employed as part of vertical farming techniques. Okay, what kind of soilless farming techniques do we employ? We employ number one, hydroponics. Okay, we employ hydroponics. Then we also employ aquaponics. We also employ aquaponics. Then we also employ aeroponics. Okay, we employ aeroponics as part of virtual farming and soilless, farming techniques. Okay, it is soilless. Okay, soilless farming technique. Okay, so correct answer for this question is option D. Okay, so that's all that I had to discuss with you for the day. Thank you so much, everyone, for attending this session. I hope you have a great day ahead. Thank you.